Hello everyone, Good Shepherds High School, Belapur. Welcome you all for online learning session. Standard 6th, Subject History, Lesson number 1, Topic, The Indian Subcontinent and History. Through this lesson, we will learn, first, to understand that geographical conditions influence human life. Second, to see how history and geography are interrelated. So, dear students, this is your cover page, History Civics Standard 6th. This is your textbook. See your new textbook. You must be very much excited to see your textbook. This is the contents. History of Ancient India. First chapter, The Indian Subcontinent and History. Here we go. Chapter number 1, The Indian Subcontinent and History. Dear students, you must be knowing there are how many continents in the world? 7 continents. I will name them. Asia, Africa, North America, South America, Antarctica, Europe and Australia. And of course, we belong to Asia continent. There are some 7 Asian countries I want to dictate. Bangladesh, China, India, Indonesia, Iraq, Mongolia, Philippines, Sri Lanka and Vietnam. You know, Asia is the largest continent and we belong to that continent. Okay, dear children. Now, here we are going to study 1.1, Geographical Conditions and the Course of History. 1.2, Geographical Features of India. 1.3, The Indian Subcontinent. Dear children, in 5th standard, we saw at some length that there is a close relationship between man and his environment. Of course, you all know that environment affects lot. We saw how the changes in the lifestyle of the early man and his technology were related to the changes in his surroundings. We also reviewed the history of human civilization from the Stone Age to the agricultural civilizations that flourished on the banks of river. You know, most previously in ancient time, when the settlement arised, that time many people settled where? Near the banks of river. Why? Because the soil was fertile. So in fertile soil, crops grow well. Here, history is a coherent account of the significant past events in the progress of human culture. Coherent means what, children? Yes? Coherent means ideas cleared easily to understand. Which kind of ideas? Significant past events in the progress of human culture. Time, place, society and individuals are the 4 major pillars of history. I will repeat again. Time, place, society and individuals are the 4 major pillars of history. We cannot write history without them, because history occurs on place and time. We should know in which society, whom it is belong to. These all things we should know, na? That's why they are called as 4 major pillars of history. Of these 4 components, place is related to geography or geographical conditions. In this sense, history and geography are inseparable. You can't separate history and geography. That's why social study we are having subject, right? Let's discuss what occupation are seen in our locality. In your locality, dear children, you all must be staying in Belapur. So big fish market is there, right? most probably you will see fisher ladies, koli people, they go for fishing and they bring nice fresh fish to sell, correct? And in Belapur was first village, now it has become city. That time people used to grow crops and the main staple food was rice, because in Konkan plenty of water is available and heavy rains, so rice is a suitable crop to grow. History is influenced by geographical conditions in many ways. Now dear children, see this. Types of houses. According to the climate and geographical area, people make their houses. Our diet, clothing, housing, occupation, in fact, all human life in any region depends to a large extent on its geographical characteristics. I want to repeat it again. Our diet means food, clothing, housing, occupation. In fact, all human life in any region depends to a large extent on its geographical characteristics. For example, the life of the people in hilly regions is more strenuous than that of people on the plains. Strenuous means needing lot of efforts. Not much fertile land is available in the hilly regions. You know hills how it is. While in the plains, it is available on a large scale. That is why grains and vegetables are scarce in hilly areas. Scarce means insufficient. In comparison, people on the plains get them in a sufficient measure. Naturally, this has an impact on the diet of the people. In hilly regions, people depend more on hunting and gathering for their food. We also find other such differences in the lifestyle of the people of the hilly regions and those of the plains. Now only we two geographical areas we took, plains and hilly regions. In this, see the differences, major differences is there. In hilly regions, people are not able to cultivate crops and all, but they hunt, go for hunting, they gather tubers, they eat all roots and fruits, everything, okay, whatever they find in the on the hills, they make the food for themselves. Okay children, it's a natural food. Here we have to cultivate in the plains. So next page, the climate, rainfall, agricultural produce, flora and fauna. These are the new words for you all. Flora means plants and plants, and fauna means animals of the region where we live are the sources of our livelihood. These are all sources of our livelihood. Because of this only we are surviving on the land. The climate, rainfall, agricultural produce, flora and fauna. Okay, the lifestyle and culture of a region develops with their support. According to that, we develop ourselves. But these are the necessity. After that only we'll wear nice clothes, then we will celebrate festivals. First, stomach, food, diet, basic necessities is required. Human settlements have flourished wherever the means of living are plentiful. Where you will be getting means of living means what? Food, clothing, shelter, climate, everything. If this is in plenty, you will get settlements there. Settlements like a society. Over a period of time, these settlements develop further into villages and towns. See, in Belapur, first it was Belapur Gao. Now it's CBD Belapur. Correct? See the development. But sometimes reasons like the degradation of the environment, sometimes environment gets spoiled. Drought means sukha pad jana, right? Means no water, no rains, invasion, etc. lead to the scarcity of those means. Because of these reasons, there will be lack of basic needs if these things happens. People are forced to leave their settlements. Drought is there, no water, how people will survive? They have to move from there. They have to leave that settlements. Villages and towns become deserted. Now, during lockdown period, you all know so many laborers went to their village. Why? Because there is no work here. This is also kind of a reason. Correct? There is scarcity of food here. That's why people are going. No money, no food. Better to go there in their natives. We see many such instances in history. And this will also be written as a history in future. Your son, your grandson, all will read such kind of a history. 2020 lockdown. Thus we see that there is a very close relation between history and geography. Now 1.2, geographical features of India. Our country India extends far and wide. बहुत जगह फैला हुआ है हमारा इंडिया. At its north lie the Himalayas. In north you will find the Himalayas. To the east you will find the Bay of Bengal. To the west the Arabian Sea. And to the south the Indian Ocean. Except for the islands of Andaman, Nicobar and Lakshadweep. These are islands, children of India. The rest of the country is contagious. What do you mean by contagious? Infectious. Infectious or transmissible. We have to take into account, we have to see that this region henceforth referred to as ancient India. When we study the ancient history of India, before 1947, today's Pakistan and Bangladesh were also a part of India before 1947. Later on they divided. The following regions are seen to be important when we look at the course of Indian history. These are the regions. First, the Himalayas. Second, the plains of Sindhu, Ganga, Brahmaputra. Third, the Thar Desert. Fourth, the Deccan Plateau. Fifth, the coastal regions. Sixth, the islands in the seas. Now, first region we will read about Himalayas. See Himalayas, oh, huge. The Hindu Kush and the Himalaya ranges have created an impenetrable wall on the northern side of the Indian subcontinent. This wall has separated the Indian subcontinent from the deserts of Central Asia. Okay? Which walls? The Hindu Kush and the Himalaya ranges. Okay? However, there is a land route through the Khyber and Bolan passes in the Hindu Kush mountains. I'll show this on the map. This route was connected to an ancient trade route. The trade route from China passed through Central Asia and reached Arabia. It is known as the Silk Route or Silk Road. I want to repeat this sentence again. The trade route from China passed through Central Asia and reached Arabia. It is known as the Silk Route or Silk Road because silk was the main commodity exported to the Western countries using this road. That's why that route was called as Silk Route. The route through the passes was used by many foreign invaders to enter ancient India. Many foreign travelers also came to India by this route. So very important route, Silk Route. See the Khyber Pass. See the picture they have given so nicely. Second point is the plains of the Sindhu, Ganga, Brahmaputra. This region consists of the basins of the three big rivers, Sindhu, Ganga, Brahmaputra and their tributaries. This region extends from Sindh, Punjab in the west to the present day Bangladesh in the east. So see, again I'll read. This region, no, the plains of Sindhu, Ganga and Brahmaputra, this region extends from Sindh, Punjab in the west to the present day Bangladesh in the east. Till this particular area it covers. It was in this region that the earliest Indian civilization of Harappa and the later states and empires of ancient India emerged. Next is Thar Desert, very vast desert. The Thar Desert. The Thar Desert spreads across Rajasthan, Haryana, and some parts of Gujarat. This can come for your objective type questions. A part of the desert lies in today's Pakistan also. Yes. The desert has the Satluj River to its north, the Aravali mountain range to its east, the run of Kutch to its south, and the Indus means Sindhu River to its west. This is the description of a Thar Desert. The Ghagar River that originates in Himachal Pradesh reaches the Thar Desert. Ghagar River reaches the Thar Desert. It is known as Hakra in Pakistan. Its course in Rajasthan and Pakistan has now dried up. Previously it used to flow river, but now it has dried up. Many sites of the Harappan civilization are situated along the now dry course of river. Now, fourth is the Deccan Plateau. The Deccan Plateau, the region between the east and the west coast of India, tapers off to the south, corner one. This region has the Arabian Sea to its west, Indian Ocean to its south, and the Bay of Bengal to its east. That's why this region, a region thus bound by the sea on three sides, is called a peninsula. A major part of the Indian peninsula is occupied by the Deccan Plateau. The mountain ranges of the Vindhya and Satpuda are located to the north of the Deccan Plateau. These are all description, children. I'm reading for you all. You should understand. Only one sentence you read, you will come to know. The Sahyadri mountain ranges are to its west. They are only showing the directions. They are also known as the Western Ghats. The Sahyadri mountain ranges are to its west, and they are also known as the Western Ghats. To the west of the Sahyadris is the coastal region, Samudra Kinara, of Konkan and Malabar. The mountains on the eastern side of the Deccan Plateau are known as the Eastern Ghats. Deccan Plateau has fertile land where many post-Harappan agrarian cultures flourished. Many different types of crops you can grow there in Deccan Plateau. Deccan Plateau was a part of the Maurya Empire, the largest in the ancient India. That time he has conquered Maurya. After the decline of the Maurya Empire, two several other kingdoms and smaller empires continued to flourish in this region. Okay, children. So here the Deccan Plateau finished. Next is the coastal regions where we survive now. From the time of the Harappan civilization, ancient India had trade relations with the Western countries, and that Western country people, it was very easy to bring all import or export activities through sea, because it was the cheapest means of transport, and now also too. This trade was carried on by sea. Therefore, India had developed contact and interaction with the foreign cultures and people at the seaports. Later on, land routes came to be used for trade and transport. But the importance of sea routes did not diminish. Wo kam nahi hua. It's now also sea route has been first preference for transport. Next is, sixth is the islands in the sea. Andaman and Nicobar are the Indian islands in the Bay of Bengal. Lakshadweep is a group of Indian islands in the Arabian Sea. This will come for fill in the blanks. The location of these islands may have been important in ancient sea trade. The manuscript Periplus of the Erythraean Sea or Handbook of the Red Sea makes a mention of Indian islands. It has been written by an unknown Greek sailor. So here page number 3 gets over. Here now little bit about map. See such a big Deccan plateau. West side western coast, east side eastern coast, eastern ghats, Sayadri mountain, western ghats. Correct no? Now we read no? We'll come here on the exercise. When we'll solve exercise no, I'll show you all everything here. Thar desert, see? Ghagar river. So beautiful Andaman Island. This is India's island. Where it is Andaman Island? In Bay of Bengal. Now, the Indian subcontinent. The cities of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro are in today's Pakistan. It is not in India, now it is in Pakistan. Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka and India together form the region known as South Asia. Children, always remember, keep it in mind. If anybody will ask you, what are the countries of South Asia? In the countries, name the countries of South Asia, you have to write the answer. Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka and India. They are our neighboring countries too, right? Considering the expanse and significance of India in this region, it is also known as the Indian subcontinent. Correct? No, it's a part of Asia continent, right? So these are the countries. The Harappan civilization had spread mainly in the northwestern part of the Indian subcontinent. I'll show you the northwestern part here. Northwestern part. This side. China and Myanmar, our neighboring countries, but they are not a part of South Asia or the Indian subcontinent. They are not a part. However, they had cultural and trade relations with ancient India. They have an important place in the study of ancient India, Indian history. Now, we'll solve exercise. Okay, children? Now what is history that I read? I'll show you. See this paragraph. History is a coherent account of the significant past events in the progress of human culture. This will be the answer. Huh? What is history? History is a, you can note it down, or if you all are having textbook, you can mark also. History is a coherent account of the significant past events in the progress of human culture. Next question. Where do human settlements flourish? Yes, dear children. Where do human settlements flourish? See here. Page number 2, human, see, page number 2, no? Yes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th line. Human settlements have flourished wherever the means of living are plentiful. Okay, next question. What do the people in the hilly region depend on for their food? So children, page number 1 from last. One, two, three, four, fifth line from last. In hilly regions, people depend more on hunting and gathering for their food. Correct? What they gather? They gather fruits, nuts. Okay? Next question. Which is the earliest civilization in India? Dear children, which is the earliest civilization in India? The Harappan civilization. Got it? The Harappan civilization. Next question. What does human life depend on? Human life is depend on what? Our diet, clothing, housing, occupation. In fact, all human life in any region depends to a large extent on its geographical characteristics. Okay, children. Next. What features of our surroundings form the means of our livelihood? I will dictate this answer. The means of our livelihood are determined by various features of our surrounding, such as, where are the children? Such as the climate, rainfall, agricultural produce, flora and fauna of the region where we live are the sources of our livelihood. Okay, children? The lifestyle and culture of a region develops with their support. Human settlements have flourished wherever the means of living are plentiful. Okay, next question. Which region is known as the Indian subcontinent? Just now we read, no, now? Yes, here it is. Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and India together form the region known as South Asia. Since India has a huge expanse and significance of India in this region is also known as the Indian subcontinent. This paragraph will be the answer. Okay, children, now give reason. There is a close relation between history and geography. Yes. Yeah. See, answer is here. I will dictate and you can refer this paragraph also. Answer is, history of a region can be described as an account of significant past events. Means from here, history is a coherent account of the significant past events in the progress of human culture. Time, place, society and individuals are the four major pillars of history. Correct? We cannot write history without them. Of these four components, the place is related to geography or geographical condition. In this sense, history and geography are inseparable. Okay, and you can write this also. History is influenced by geographical conditions in many ways. Got it, children? Next question is what? People are forced to leave their settlements. Why? What must be the reason, children? Yes, we read no here. sea. Over a period of time, these settlements develop further into villages and towns, but sometimes reason like the degradation of the environment, drought, invasion, etc. led to the scarcity of those means and people are forced to leave their settlement. Villages and towns become deserted. Okay, children, next is, this will be assignment for you. Explain the difference in human life in the hilly regions and that on the plains. Okay, these are the various costumes. According to the geographical area, people wear their costumes. Here, observe the physical map. I will read these questions. We will observe the physical map of India and answer the question based on it. This is our map, children. First question is, which mountain ranges lie in the north of India? See the direction they have showed, north. Here it is north. Which mountain ranges? See, first is Hindu Kush Mountain and this is Himalaya Mountain. Got it? These two mountain ranges lie in the north of India. Which are the routes of India from the northeast? See, north, this is north side, this is north side, east side, correct? Now, which are the routes to India from the northeast? Which are the routes to India from the northeast? Here are they, Bangladesh and Myanmar. Where do the Ganga and Brahmaputra meet? This is Ganga. And this is Brahmaputra. Sorry. Where they meet? They meet in Bangladesh. Hena? See, no, Ganga comes from here. Brahmaputra comes from here. And they meet in Bangladesh. Name the islands to the east of Indian Peninsula. East side. Where is the east side? Here it is. And which are the islands? Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Correct. In which part of India do we see the Thar Desert? Thar Desert, where it is? See, northwest part of India. Up is north and this side is west, so northwest. Okay, northwest part of India. Next activity that you have to do at home: obtain information about the lakes or reservoir in your locality. And show the following on a world map. What? The Himalaya Mountain, the Silk Road, Arabia. Got it, children? Okay. Here, your lesson gets over.